therefore the essential message of that never ended.
So what's the message?
It's a Gemara in Sanhedrin, Chelek, where there's a bunch of people. Are you familiar with this? Oh, okay, so where there's a several Amoraim, Rabbi Yochanan, Ilfa, I think, whatever, that say about the coming of Mashiach. It says, Yese, let him come. Lo yechmine, I don't want to be there. I don't want to see it. It's come on. It's astounding. How could you not want to see the Mashiach? Mm-hmm. You know, that's a very profound secret. Why they don't want to see it. You know? So the question is, what do they mean? You don't remember that? Come on.
I remember.
What?
I remember.
You know? I remember you discussed this in a cafe.
Who?
You discussed this in a cafe.
I did?
Yes, you did.
A couple of weeks ago.
This?
Yes.
What did I say?
You said that they didn't want to see it because
yeah.
they were totally connected with Hashem. In other words, they were completely, there was a total connection there. And these times, you're going to lose that type of connection or something of that sort.
No, because there's Hester pointing to,
right.
to an extent that never existed.
Exactly.
Oh, okay, good. I forgot it. It's called Mi'at Or, the diminishment of light.
Right.
You know. So therefore, the Xer in the end, or the environment in the end, has to be incredible diminishment of Ruchnius. Spirituality, Ruchnius, Guru Islam, the connection. That's what it means, and there will be a hunger, not for water, and not for bread. Mm-hmm. The hunger is for Ruchnius. And therefore the Xer of the end has to be incredible darkness. So, how do you create darkness? Well, the first thing you have to do is kill Jews. Because every Jewish person brings in light. Just by his presence, his neshama. That's the concept of Mi'at Or. That's why it says, Ma'at min ha'or, a little light, doich ha'av min ha'choshech, will scatter an enormous amount of darkness. Mm-hmm. See? So the first thing you have to do, if you want to diminish Ruchni, is kill Jews.
The plan of the Nazis was not to kill the Jews. It was to take them and send them out of Europe to any country that would take them.
In the one see, that's when it happened, when they decided the final solution is to actually kill the Jews.
And that was because no country would take them.
But I'm not talking about the Nazis, I'm talking about the Hashgoch and Rajabayim.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
I'm not talking about what the Nazis wanted.
Okay.
Right? Therefore, that's the real zero of that Shoya, was Mi'at Or. The first way to begin is to kill 6 million, or half the Jewish people. And not only that, you want to close the door? Because they eat. But the main thing is, the ones that were killed was the real Ruchnistiger aspect of Israel. Lithuania, the Litta, Germany, the Litta. You know what I'm saying? Those were the educational or Torah elite, so to speak. You know what I'm saying? They were destroyed. So therefore, after them, there was an enormous, darkness of terror, and so on. But there has to be some terror, right? So therefore, there you had certain Gedolim bringing the Or back, right? Rabban Kotler, you know, you had an upswing in Kolatz Chazonish, right? Mm-hmm. But the Roshon, the Mi'at Or there never ended. So therefore, all of a sudden, the Reform, the Conservative, the Constructionist, and the Maskilim, the Heir of Rav, and they now popped up, and they destroyed the rest of the Jews. Wow. Right? You're looking at a continuation of the Shoya. Except, but what people don't understand is the Shoya is not a physical destruction. It is a destruction of spirituality. So first was physical, to remove the Jew. Then the second thing was what? To destroy the Judaism, even though you don't kill the Jews, and therefore all the Jews that went to the West, you know, the West and so on and so forth, right? All those Jews that went to the West, you know, these movements destroy the Jews. You see? So it's a second Shoah. It's a Shoah, you see, you know. But the Ashkenazim, the Gzera, was the physical destruction. But the Sfardim were also destroyed. Really, you know, they destroyed all the, you know, the place of the Sfardim. They came to America, and Edom and Erev Rav, Esav and Edom, wiped out the rest. Right? So either the Erev Rav or you have Esav, which is the incredible distractions of the West, the American culture, the European culture, you see? But it's a continuous onslaught of the Mi'at Or. That's the second wave. The third wave, which I hate to say, is called third wave is yeshivas. Is it song?
Yes.
Uh-oh.
Shall we pray?
Where most guys, unfortunately, come on yeshiva, hardly remember anything. You know, a guy 30 years old who's gone to yeshiva for 20 years, what does he really know in the end? Very few know. You know, very, very few have really mastered after 20 years. You know, you could produce a top engineer. Once you look at a 20-year-old, a 30-year-old guy who's gone to yeshivas for 20 years, you know, learning tomorrow and all that, what does he know, really? That's the third Mi'at Or, where even the yeshivas suffer from an enormous amount of diminishment of Torah. So, the Holocaust never ended.
Steinman said, my son went to a meeting with a rabbi, he said, most brochim who go to yeshiva in Gedoyla can't learn Boshab Shad. Ulai in Koyla.
Maybe in Koyla. So Steinman.
Steinman.
Yeah.
2.5 years ago.
2.5 years ago. Wow. That said what? That most brochim?
Most brochim come to yeshiva in Gedoyla can't learn Boshab Shad.
Cannot learn Boshab Shad.
Ulai in Koyla.
And maybe in the Quill they can figure more
about it. But time to get to Quill, perhaps.
Yeah, yeah. And you know what the major reason is? Which is astounding. The major reason why most people, even when they're 30 years old, have hardly ever mastered Torah, you know. The reason why is because they violate the educational sequence. You know, in order to know any Chochmah, you have to know what's called a database. You have to know Yediyas first. And then you can learn advanced material. Gemara is advanced halachic problems, which they now go through an entire argument process to solve them. That's advanced. Right? I've said this many times. Gemara presupposes that you have a massive database of Mishnayos, maybe the Sefta. You know what I'm saying? That's what you have to know. I can go into, it's like going into graduate school without ever having gone in undergraduate. You know, it's like you want to be a physicist, and instead of taking undergraduate core courses, you go into graduate school physics. And that's advanced. You don't know what they're talking about. So the thing with Gemara is that they've created conversations where a Rebbe will get up and give you a shiur. You know, so therefore, you can make your way into a Gemara because somebody's actually explaining it and so on, but in the end, it's still an advanced. It still presupposes enormous database, you know, a tremendous, the big picture, which is the information, and so on, even with a shiur. And today, most shiurim are pilpul. They're all pilpul, they're all advanced. They don't even give you the advantage of a database, basically, you know. So the Gemara is advanced, and the Shir is advanced. How can anybody make it, really? You know, it's a nest that anybody walks out of yeshiva knowing anything with this kind of a system, you know. It's literally learning advanced material first without ever learning the basic core information. And therefore, you need to learn Shnayos.
So what's the obstacle in your... Your Yeshua, the one that teaches them to correct people. Knowing that there's a massive problem out here that needs to be addressed, it would seem logic would dictate that yours would be the most in demand of anyone.
And the answer is, I just told you, the Xer of me is all.
Okay, here you go.
That's why I wanted to do that. Yeah. The Bersha wants to create an enormous amount of chushach, darkness. Because it says, and there's darkness on the face of the deep. ruach elokim rachefes apneh, and the spirit of God hovers over the waters, obviously in the midst of the darkness. So the Baal HaTurim says that the gematria of the ruach elokim rachefes, the gematria of that is zuhi ruchoi shel melech hamashiach. It's the Baal HaTurim. That this is the ruach of the Mashiach that hovers over the yam in the middle of the darkness. So therefore the entry of the Mashiach has to be an incredible darkness. But it doesn't mean darkness of life, it means darkness of ruchnis. And that's what the Navi means. That there will be an incredible hunger and thirst in the land, but it's not for lechem and it's not for water. What is it for? Ruchnis. That's
the
nevuah, that there's going to be an unbelievable mi'ut or, a diminishment of light. Ruchnis. And that is why we are in the situation we are in. You see?
But isn't there a level where you get so far deep into it, there's no return?
Deep into what?
Deep into a mute of or. Like, for instance, in Mitzrayim, we have to be pulled out of Mitzrayim very, very quickly.
Exactly,
If we didn't leave then, the show would be over.
Yeah.
Right? So we're vast approaching that area right now. In other words, we're the mute or is increasing and increasing. And unless something happens quickly...
It's over.
It's over.
Correct. That's why the Ramchal says, Ad v'le'ad b'chlav. It's like, imagine a house that's dark, right? And the windows are black, right? And the windows, you shut the windows, because so if you shut the outside light, the whole house is pitch black. The only light entering the house is through a thin sliver of light that the windows didn't shut. You see? Mm-hmm. So that's what the Ramchal says, that those windows will shut almost completely. But there's a small amount of light left, and we are being nourished from that small amount of light. Meanwhile, most of the house is black. That's the situation we are in. You see? Mi'ator. So the astounding conclusion is that people do not understand what the Shoya is. One of the essential ideas of the Shoya, one of them, there are many, is the concept that it was a situation that created mi'ator. It destroyed spirituality. And like I said, the way to begin that process is to kill the Jews. Because every Jew is an or. And therefore, the less Jews there are, the less ruchnis in the world. Not only that, what was destroyed in the Holocaust was the cream of Torah Jewry. You know, the main major lands was Germany, Latvia, Lithuania, you know, and so on. That's where the main tailor was, you know, and so on. The ones who survived most of the war was the, Hungary and Romania and so on, which wasn't, I think, as academically or intellectually, academically Torah knowledgeable as the Eastern Europe, you know? Mm-hmm. So therefore, there was an unbelievable darkness. See, it wasn't complete, but it was like, what the Bajan did is very interesting. Usually, there's a concept called a diminishment or a descent of ruchnis, right? But it takes hundreds of years to see the descent. Think about it, right? You had the Tanoim. So the year of Tanoim were about, let's say, 300 years. Well, you had more. You had the Zugos, the pears, you know, so they were... First you had the Anshik, well, you go back, but if you start from the Anshik Knesset Geulah, the men of the Great Assembly, that was tremendous. Right? And they lasted a couple hundred years. Then finally, it evolved into what's called the Zugos, the pears. You know what I'm saying? And that was less of a ruchnis, but it was still tremendous. Right? And then that lasted a couple hundred years. And then it went into, Yisben Yueze, the whole Pirkei Avos. And then that descended into the period of the Tanoim. And that lasted a couple hundred years. Then it descended into the period called the Amoroim. That was a couple hundred years, right? And then after the Amoraim came the Rabbonim Sivoroim. That lasted about 200-300 years. Then after them came the Goinim. That lasted 200-300 years. Then came the Rishonim, a couple hundred years. And then came the Achroinim. That lasted a couple hundred years. And we are now in the era of the Tachtoinim.
The underwears.
Yeah. With the Tachtoinim, gone are the Achroinim.
The undergarments, right?
Yeah. Yes, but the interesting thing about that, what do you see? Is that before Klai Yisrael can notice that there's a significant descent of ore, it takes a couple of years. You see? Mm-hmm. So each one of these things are a couple of years. Because all of a sudden, you know, they woke up and said, hey, wait a minute. We're way below the guys before us. And that took a couple of years until the descent could now initiate, legitimately, a new tkufa, you see. So the Rebbeim had a massive problem. What was the problem? Because you had the Achronim, the end of the Achronim period, right? Oh. Right before the Holocaust. And the Rebbeim said, listen, there's a certain amount of diminishment of Ruchnias, but it's not enough to bring the Mashiach. So between here, before the Holocaust, let's say 1920, right? And the darkness that has to go before the Mashiach is an unbelievable amount of descent. That will take 800 years in what's called the natural progression of the descent of Torah. You notice how it descends? But that takes, so imagine, let's say 1920, let's say 1900, you know, right? To go from the darkness of 1900 to the darkness which is the Ikris de Mashiach, take 500-600 years. But you only have what? You only have about 280-60 years left from Mashiach. There's not enough time.
So you need internet.
So you need what's called acceleration. So part of the concept of the Holocaust was an enormous acceleration. So from 1939 to 1945 was the equivalent of 500 years of descent of Ruchnius.
From when to when?
From 1939, which is the beginning of the Holocaust, until 1945. Was equivalent in the amount of diminishment of Ruchnias and the amount of Torah scholarship in Klai Yisrael, it was equivalent to 500 years, maybe 600 years. But you see, because the Rebbeim doesn't want to wait 600 years, you know what I'm saying? So what he did is he accelerated the process. How? By one, killing 6 million Jews, right? And that's an incredible diminishment of all. And then the Jews that died were the elite, the intellectually Torah scholarship elite, right? Then what he did is after they were wiped out, he introduced the heir of Rav, the leaders, right, which are the reformed, conservative, reconstructionists in America and Europe and so on, right? And in Israel it was the Maskilim, the Mapai, these guys now wiped out the rest, what was left over. And the continuation of that Mi'at'or is that people think, right, that you can be a Talmud Chochem if you're no more 10 years old without any concept of Mishnais or database. So the Mi'at Or, you don't realize, is on the entire Klai Yisrael, including the yeshivas. They don't realize that. And one of the incredible ways the Rosh Hashanah is able to do this is because most people think that the mitzvah of learning Torah isn't knowing, it's learning. Mm-hmm. Rabbi once said that?
Yeah.
That people think that learning Torah is the only thing you have to do, because that's also a mitzvah. The problem is the real mitzvah is to know the Torah, but of course you have to learn the Torah first. So people think because learning Torah itself is a mitzvah, I don't have to know it. There's no mindset about knowing. That's the churban. So that fools everybody. That's why a guy can go to yeshiva and sit there for 10 years, and he knows that he doesn't hardly remembers anything, right? Why? Because he think, I got a mitzvah of learning Torah, which is true. He did get a mitzvah of Torah, you see, but that's that what fools everybody.
What's ironic is that being the case, and yet right now we're in the Tekufa where we now see all the different mephorshim being laid out in front of us.
Yeah, yeah.
The information's there,
Mamish.
It's not being used.
Used, exactly. Today the availability and the accessibility of Torah is unprecedented. It's incredible. Between, you know, you see there's art scroll, right? Schottenstein art scroll, Shas, Mishnais, then you have Mesifta, which does all the legwork for you, right? In the old days, you had to have 80 Sfarim in front of you looking this up. Today, you just so open the Mesifta and it's all there. You don't realize, it's incredible. But there are two things that are happening simultaneously, if you realize that. The first thing is that the Torah, Ruchnius, is incredibly difficult to access. Interesting. You see? And that's the Gezerah of Mi'at Or. That's the decree that there must be a diminishment of light, and I'm showing you how it happened, and so on.
And that, but the that difficulty of ruchnius is evidenced by the fact that there's the learning without ruchnius within it?
Well, first of the fact is, number one, is that 12 million Jews are gone.
Okay.
They're gone. No Shabbos, no Kashrus, no nothing. They're gone, finished. 93% of Jews are gone. There's only 7% left. And of those 7%, you have many variations of their attachment to ruchnius. You know what I'm saying?
Where do you get that 93%?
Well, if you look at, if there's 30 million Jews in the world,
okay,
you know, and there's only, let's say, 12 million that are gone, what's left? 1.5 million that are from?
Remember, that's all there is?
That's all there is, yeah. That's all there is.
Yeah.
Yeah, most of America is gone. You don't realize, you know?
I don't really.
I speak a lot all around the world, and every time I get to a city, I'd ask how many Jews are in the city. So I remember I went to one city, it's only 80,000 Jews. But there's only 1,000 on the front.
Yeah.
That's all. You know, almost every city in Los Angeles, one of the biggest communities in the world, how many front Jews do you think there are really? 30,000, maybe? There are 500,000 Jews in Los Angeles
area.
Really? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And how many Jews do you think are from? From means what?
Shabbos,
yeah, so we're basically Shabbos, Yom Tov, Kashrus, Taras Mishpacha. I mean, those are the basic things, right? Davening and so on, right? How many do you think? Maybe 30,000 tops, 40,000? Out of 500,000 Jews, right? So 10% is 50,000, and it's less, probably half of that. So we're looking at 2.5, 3, 4, 5%. So what's left? Well, this is LA. What about the other cities are much worse?
I lived on the West Coast for many years. The only yeshivas in the West are in LA and Denver.
So that's it.
Talking a wide section
probably
of
a little more now, but
not maybe small. Is anything in Seattle?
Yeah, now
they're good. What about Denver?
You're not talking a full blown.
Yeah. And you know how many Jews are spread over the West?
I know. I lived in Oregon, Washington, California.
Yeah, Oregon? Where in Oregon did you live?
I was in Corvallis. Is
that near which? Was that north or south?
I thought it was Oregon State University, University of Oregon.
That's in, what's the name of the city?
Eugene,
yeah.
It's Chabad there, man.
Yeah.
Small Orthodox community. Small.
But I'm just saying, so therefore, if you look at it, at least 93% of Jews are gone. I mean, something, if you went to the hospital and you looked at a guy, 93% of his body was dead, what would you say about the guy? Pretty far gone.
Yep.
In fact, he's dead. He just doesn't know it yet.
Jews living in New York have no idea what's happening in the rest of the country.
Nothing.
They have no clue.
And we're not even talking about Europe.
Yeah.
We're not talking about Europe or South America. I mean, forget about the assimilation there.
America's huge. Argentina's huge.
Massive. Well, you know, Venezuela, Argentina, it's huge, the assimilation. And you're talking about Europe? Well, I mean, for me, you're not there in Europe, you know? What else is left? You know, and even in Israel. How many real frumos Jews? I'm not talking about traditionalists, which there are, thank God, more, you know. But how many for secular are there? Enormous, you see? So wherever you look at it, the 13, 14 million Jews, maybe 12 million are gone, you see? So what did it take to do that to the Jews? It was a gzeir of miyut all. And that's why in the Gemara and Sanhedrin, you have many Amroim saying, Yesei, let the Mashiach come, v'lo yechmine, I don't want to see him. Because they realized, because if you look at a tzaddik, right, and you ask yourself, what kind of tzaddik not want? What was so difficult about the period of the Mashiach, or before actually, that a tzaddik wouldn't want? Tzaddikim are not afraid of persecutions. That's bad news. What bothers a tzaddik is the inability to access spirituality. Ruchnius. That's what bothers a real tzaddik, you know? So when a person like Rabbi Yochanan says, Yesei v'lo yechmine, this is Rabbi Yochanan, what bothers him is the fact that there's persecutions and so on. It's terrible. But the real thing about it is that God is gone. The availability of ruchnius is incredibly difficult. Anyway.
But even within the yeshiva system, to get people to teach a little bit of hashgafa, like take away a drop of Gemara and just teach a little hashgafa,
Is
almost like, if I might make such a suggestion, they look at me like I'm from another planet.
Yeah, because you don't realize something. That's all satanic.
What part? Not my suggestion.
What it is, let me tell you something. No, not your suggestion.
Okay.
Although they look at it static.
That's what I wasn't sure if you were implying.
No. I mean, if you look at it, where do you see this? It's in the Torah. We're coming up to it. It's on, I think. Or Be'elech, whatever, right? Right? V'anochi hastir astir ponei b'yom ha'ru. And it's a double lashon. And I will surely conceal my face on that day. Wow. Like, God is saying, you think it's going to be a, you know, you're going to have ruchnis all over the place? You guys have no idea what's going to happen before Mashiach comes. So the question is, what is a double lashon of hester? So there are different ways of learning. One is that hester, nochi hester, that most of Klai Yisrael I will hide my face from. Hester, Esther, is even the gedolim won't see me. You know, I remember I once went to a tisha of the Biyana Rebbe, a long time ago, you know. And he said that even tzaddikim hardly have any ruchnis anymore. Compared to the tzaddikim of what used to be, Ruach HaKodesh, and you know, and so on and so forth. Even we suffer that we hardly have any connection to the Ribbono Shel Olam. He said that. That's what he means. So here's the way he types the word, was the Hamoy Naam, the people. And even the Tzaddikim hardly can access the Ribbono Shel Olam. Amazing. But then there are other ways. I will conceal myself. Not only will I conceal myself, but there will be a hester that they even have a hester. They won't even know there's a hester. That's the tragedy. So at least you know there's a hester, so you can try to do something about it. But if you think that it's molly or, you'll never do anything about it. That's the worst situation to be in. You see? That's today. That's your answer.
That's like that.
They don't even know the hester of what's happening in yeshivas. Forget about the hamoinam. They're gone. You know? And so on. Forget about the balei tshuva. These guys are basically doomed to be amaratzim. Because how do you undo all the time wasted? You know, look how long it takes even to a guy in yeshiva to become Talmud Chacham. Forget about them. But even yeshiva guys, what do they know after 30 years old? It's like I always say, you know, if you ever went over to a doctor who's 30 years old, and he knew as much as a yeshiva guy who's 30 years old, he would kill you.
You know a lot of facts.
What?
You know a lot of facts, but nothing connected.
Who?
Doctor, yeah.
No, he wouldn't know the facts. What are you talking about?
You know?
What does a guy 30 years old know? Why do you think everybody's joining Daf Yomi? Because it's the act of the desperate. Daf Yomi has nothing to do with education. You don't know anything when you finish Daf Yomi. What do you know? The only thing a guy can say when he finishes Daf Yomi is, I forgot the whole shas.
Way too fast.
Right? You could say that.
Yeah.
But Daf Yomi does have its advantages for people who are in a gezer of miyador. By the way, that's why there is a Daf Yomi. If you realize that. One of the reasons why there is a Daf Yomi, Meir Shapiro, why? Because the Russian put it into his mind, actually wasn't him, it was the Chotkova. But anyway, why? Because in a gezer in the time of miyador, then everybody's finished. Finished. So the Russian says, I got to give you guys at least a taste of Torah. It's called a taste of Torah, you know. And therefore, Daf Yomi was created. So Daf Yomi gives a person a taste of Torah. You see? That's why. Daf Yomi only makes sense in a time of a terrible gzera of Miat Or. But that gzera has to come before the Mashiach, as they brought the Pasuk. You see? The climate has to be of unbelievable hester upon. See, that's why none of the Amoraim wanted to live it, to be here. You know, you think they'd love to see Mashiach, wow. But they couldn't stand the fact that the conditions that will come before the Mashiach will be absolutely horrendous. And I don't mean the destruction of physical Jewry. I mean the fact that you walk around today, you know, where's Ruchnius? Where is it, really, in terms of what's going on today? So the Holocaust was the first stage of the Gzera. The next stage was Israel with the Maskilim, the heir of Rav, which are the leaders, right? And the Reformed, Conservative, Reconstructionists. That was the next stage, you see, of terrible darkness, you see? And then the next stage, unfortunately, tragedy in many ways, and there are people out there that will disagree with me, I'm telling you now, you know, they'll think I'm out of my mind. But it's true. The yeshivas itself are being dumbed down. Because the way they learn, nobody knows anything. Hardly anybody remembers anything. Because they're all learning advanced material first. It's like going to graduate school without knowing anything beforehand. And the second thing that dumbs down everybody, that makes the hester, is that everybody thinks that it's okay to learn and not to know. I told you once, they once asked Reb Chaim Kanievsky, how do you remember everything? I told you this.
Sure.
They asked him, how do you remember everything? Which means, how do you know everything? And he answered, Valach Vil, because I want to. He wants to know, not just to learn. You know, it's like one guy once said, met another guy and said, wow, Mordechai, you know, he's incredible. You know, he learns all the time. You know, he knows. So the guy said, no, he doesn't know anything. He's too busy learning. Huh. What can he know? He's too busy learning. You see, knowing is a different activity than learning. It requires mindset. It requires review periodically. It's a whole different idea, you see. I can show you one idea, and then, you know, Gemara. The fundamental unit of a Gemara is a sugya. And a sugya is a problem-solving format, right? It produces a problem, contradiction, whatever. Right? And you have a whole shakna vitaya argument to solve the problem, resolve the problem, and then has a solution. Right? Why is it people don't remember Gemara? Because 95% of Gemara is shakna vitaya. Nobody remembers that. So you think at least when you get to the maskana, right? Take the maskana and look it up in the Shulchan Aruch. So what you've done is you've made it from a resolution into a fact. Because the Shulchan Aruch is facts. The maskana is a solution. So you think at least look up the fact, the solution in the Shulchan Aruch, and then it becomes a fact, and a fact you remember. Nobody does that. They just go on. Because everybody sees the solution as part of the Shakya Vataya. And it's just, that's it. You know, you just throw it into the bundle with the Shakya Vataya, and it's out of the mind. That's why a poisek is much better off than a yeshiva guy. That is not a poisek. Because a poisek has to remember, and he learns the Shulchan Aruch, which is the facts, without the sugya. You see? Really what they should introduce is the fact that every yeshiva guy has to be a poisek. And then they would remember much more. Because, you know, it's like, you gotta know your stuff. You don't know your stuff, you can't be a poisek. You see? So the fact that you're a poisek demands that not only you learn, but you know. Therefore, every maskana becomes a halacha, which is yediyah, and that you remember. These are simple educational ideas that nobody thinks about. And all of this is introduced to, in many ways, to dumb down Klal Yisrael, in order to allow Mi'at Or, the enormous amount of Hester of Torah, right before the coming of the Mashiach.
And this is because we're not learning, we're not getting through merit, which would have been plan A.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
There was a potential plan.
One of the reasons, one of the reasons for Daf Yomi, which I just told you, is in the time of Mi'at Or, you need Daf Yomi, or else you're finished. I mean, without that, there's no Torah, because it's a gzir of Mi'at Or. So therefore, Daf Yomi has to be, so at least you have some kind of taste of Torah. You see? But a second idea is that the only way to bring Torah to Klal Yisrael, without going into the whole thing, to break the klipa of Torah, is Mesiras Nefesh, Amelis. That's why Amelis is so important in Torah, right? One of the Amelis is, so the problem the Moshe faces, Kaviyocho, is in a time where there's hardly any Torah, there's no Amelis. So now how are you going to break the Sotan or the Klipa that surrounds the Torah, right? And the answer is Amelis in the form of Mesiras Nefesh. So the fact that a guy gets up for 7.5 years in the morning to go to a daf, that Amelis, not the idea, but the Amelis itself breaks the klipa and brings the tikkun. That's the second secret of why there's Daf Yomi. You see? But I'll tell you one thing, which is interesting. As Klal Yisrael gets further and further from the Torah is coming out of the klipa. That's the interesting thing about it. That's why Torah is so much more available. You see? That's why all of a sudden you have art scroll, Gemara, you have Masifta, Mishnayos, all this stuff is coming out, never available before. In other words, right now, Torah is coming with unbelievable amount of explanations. Mm-hmm. And the only reason that that could happen is that the Torah is emerging from the Golas, which is interesting. Mm-hmm. So as the Torah is emerging from the Golas, the Jews are going into the Golas more and more.
So what do you mean? As we're getting closer to the Mashiach, there is a...
Yeah, well, that's what it means, to get closer to Mashiach. It means the Golos has to end for five things. There are five things that go into Golos automatically, because they're all identical at different levels. The first thing that goes into Golos is the Shechina, the Divine Presence. The second thing is the Torah. And this is the Golos of the Torah. Third thing is the Jews. The fourth thing is Eretz Yisrael. And the fifth thing is, I consider the fifth is called Lashon HaKodesh, the Hebrew language, which is really part of the Torah. And now take a look. Mm-hmm. Hebrew is spoken all over. That's out of the Golas, right? Mm-hmm. Right? Eretz Yisrael, Jews are back. Although we're still in Golas, but look at the difference. It's fascinating. Amazing. You know, Israel is now back in the hands of the Jews, which all the Catholic Church is going up the wall because of that. Right? But the Jews are now out of what? They're now in Israel. That's the beginning of the Golas. You know, I mean, there are people that are going to argue with me, whatever, but whatever, right? The third thing is the Jews are going out of Golas. Why? Because the nations of the world can no longer hold them in. That's why Russians are leaving Russia. Syrians are leaving, the Jews, Syrian Jews are leaving Syria. The nations can no longer hold them in Golas. So therefore the Jews are coming out of the Golas and returning voluntarily. You see?
In some cases,
that's
voluntarily. But they don't come voluntarily, they've been thrown out.
Well, whatever it is, they're coming.
Right.
That's the kibbutz goyos.
You know, not only that.
Right?
No, 50, over 50% of Korea, South Korea, is now Christian.
Yeah, you know South Korea learned Gemara?
And they instituted learning the Gemara because
yeah.
of that.
Yeah.
They still have so the same problem we have. They won't know what they're
Yeah, they don't know what they're talking about.
Japanese calling.
Yeah, so like,
what's today's dafyom?
So when the Torah, as you're saying, when the Torah comes out, it's also spreading ladder.
So they wait. So we got three things coming out of the Golas, right? We've got Lashon HaKodesh, Israel, Jews, right? And the next thing is Torah. Torah is coming out of the Golas. How? That's what art school is. You think somebody can come up with a plan and have money for art school if the Torah is in the Klipa in the Golas? Of course not. This exerah that keeps it in the Golas. But Elamai, the Golas is ending for Torah, slowly, that therefore all of a sudden there's an incredible hashpor of hatzlocha. You need to change the face of Gemara. Until now, Gemara, every third word was missing, and there's no background information, and Gemara's a notebook, and so on. That's ending, that's what art school did, right? They have the background information, they insert the unstated thought inside the Gemara, and all that, they have the Iyun there, you know, so it's not just art school, it started the revolution. Masifta carried it through in the Gemara. Now all the stuff you need to know is in the back of Masifta. It's astounding. You know, even if they have 350 volumes, you know? But you could be a Rosh Hashiva without just Masifta. You just read the... it's Chinese. Or Japanese. But anyway... So you have translations, you have Sadi Deshmaya, you have guys writing, you know, it's astounding what's going on with Torah, because Torah is slowly coming out of the Klipa, which is interesting.
So you where's see? The Hester?
Wait?
Yeah, good, okay. Good. Good question.
So...
But what's missing?
Shechina.
Divine presence, yeah. That's still in the Golas. That's the last thing to come out. And that's Mashiach. The Mashiach is who brings the Divine Presence out of the Golas. But that's the end. And then the entire world changes.
Yeah. And they're not all out of the Golas completely.
Who?
The Torah, all the ones that are
no,
coming
it's not,
out,
it's
they're
emerging.
Still emerging.
It's not out. But, I mean, Torah out of the Golas is the Om Mashiach. That's out of the Golas. But it's emerging, which means that it's now easier to learn. It's easier to learn now. And now, what about the Torah tapes? You know? I can get on the, not the internet, but Torah tapes, you know. You can listen to the whole Shas now on audio or video. Audio, basically, right? That never happened. That means you don't even need to go to a yeshiva anymore, basically. You can hear advanced Torah. I mean, Kol HaLashon. Kalashin guys, like 30, 40,000 shiurim. You could, if you want, you could spend your days listening to Torah, shiurim on daf yomi, everything, you know? With guys who are having a great, great explanations, you have Torah and hashkofa and mitzvahs and musa and stories. You name it, what's out there. It's astounding what's out there. That's Torah coming out of the goals. But it's interesting. At the same time, the gzeir is ending for Torah to be available, but the ones who learn it are still in the goals. Yes. Because the gzeir of miyut or is still here. The diminishment of ruchnias is still upon us. You see. When that comes out of the goals, get ready. As they say, polish your shoes. Yeah. When the availability of Torah will match the availability of the Jews themselves to want to learn the right way, that's the real beginning of the end. That's always the end. Yeah. And so on. You are looking at history. This is the interpretation of history for the last 60 years, which most people don't know. That's what I'm just giving you. 21st century Shia. In terms of the Holocaust itself, you know, interesting.
Mm-hmm. In the show, there's also tremendous Isurim.
Yeah, of course. That's always the Isurim is part of the Kapora. Yeah. But like I say, the Holocaust has many dimensions, as you see now. One of them is Miyador. Another one was acceleration of the Choshech. And instead of taking 800 years, it happens 6.
The Isurim helps the acceleration.
Yeah, well, exactly, yeah. Yeah, those, you know, where do you find this acceleration? Where do you find this? Everything has a precedent. Where do you find this? It's really all in the Torah. Remember when Paro and Moshe Rabbeinu came to Mitzrayim? Uh-huh. And Paro said, these guys are lazy? So what did he do? He enormously intensified the Isurim of Klal Yisrael for the next year. That is the equivalent of the Holocaust. Really what it is, you see, that, you know, so therefore there was an enormous intensification of the, so imagine everybody's got, not only are they in Golos and Mitzrayim, right, so at least when they went home, they had a normal home life, if you call that normal, right, now at night they had to run around Egypt gathering straw. What could you can't learn anymore, whatever learning there was going on, which I'm sure there was, it's over with, there's no learning, there's no family life, there's no nothing, you see what I'm saying, mm-hmm. So that is being replicated now. We are now in the time period of the Jews after Moshe Rabbeinu came, which is interesting. So maybe the Mashiach has arrived, except he's not telling anybody. That would be interesting, you know. But if you look at, you know, and then what happened next? What happened next? Then all of a sudden the Jews left, right? And then they got out. Then they left. And right by Kriya Samsif, what happened? There was a reattempt of Paro to take over the Jews, right? That's Goyim and Mogoyim. Goyim and Mogoyim is when they realize that they're dying and they want to take over again and kill the Mashiach and Klal Yisrael. Again, it's all...
That was a trick because Hashem made them make a right turn.
No, you're focusing on... Forget about that. I'm talking about the fact that the Egyptians wanted to recapture the Jews.
Yeah.
That concept is the concept of Goyim and Mogoyim.
That means Gog and Magog has to happen after Mashiach is here.
Correct.
Another
it's
question.
A messianic war.
So another question is that if it really isn't true, Haster, Haster Panim, why? Because even in Israel today, we can look and see the miracles that Hashem does for us, even though he's behind the scenes. So what does that mean? What does the Pasuk really mean when he says the Biut Or will be so low? Because he never detaches.
Never.
In other words, because if he did detach...
Well, it'd be, it's over.
It's over, right?
Yeah.
So what does it mean?
What
does it mean, Aster? What does it really mean? It means that he's not really hiding his face.
In other words, 98% of it is hidden. That's pretty hidden.
But he still protects Israel. In other words, you could say we're all chayav, and why should he protect Israel with the way that he protects Israel?
You're confusing two topics.
Okay, what am I confusing?
I'll tell you what you're confusing. One topic is the fact that he's always protects Israel. But now it's a complete behester. It's the concept of the Purim Megillah, right? Mm-hmm. We saved the Jews, but you didn't see him. It looked like a bunch of coincidences, didn't it? Purim looks like a bunch of incredible luck, of the Jews. You know, you can go through the incredible coincidences that you realize could never have happened, except now the Jew, the Anhog of the Bersham is called coincidences. It's not open anymore. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you look at the coincidence and say, wow, you know, what was the probability that this is going to happen? You know, and so on, you know. So that's really what he did in terms of Purim, right? I mean, you can go through the Yavi, go through the coincidence of Purim.
Sure.
It's impossible to have happened. Really? It's an impossible story.
Right.
You know, but it happened. Again, because that's how the Bansham saves, you know. So that's one concept, is God is always there to save us, but through coincidences, and that's the cloaking device that he's able to hide from us, you know. But the second thing is us, we ourselves, we want to know God. Mm-hmm. We want to be oyvdim, we want to be an Eved Hashem, right? You know how hard it is to be an Eved Hashem?
Sure.
As soon as you walk out in the street, gone is your avdus, and you now become an Eved to a different Avodah Zarah. It's impossible.
It's much worse in America than here. Here you can walk out of this like a
ship
in the streets. I mean,
that's the difference.
Which is worse?
I was thinking it's easier here in Israel than it is in America. If you walk down the streets of New York City, it's much more challenging.
Oh, yeah, I don't know about that. You check out, you walk down Yafo during the middle of the day, we'll see how long the Ruchnias last. differ from that.
It's pathetic,
know?
Even in the most religious communities today in Israel.
The children,
where does it come from that they're thinking about the Palm Pilots and this and that, where they should be almost completely severed from these ideas. Yeah,
it's also the tzniyas. You ever walk down this street here? I mean, I hate to say it. I'm not from America, which is all for goyim. Okay, now what do you expect, you know? You walk down, you get a lesson in what's called tzniyas, what's called not tzniyas. That's what it is. It's a terrible situation that we're in. And therefore, it's very hard to become an oyved. Mm-hmm. Remember, Torah is part of the avoida. You know what I'm saying? That's the mistake everybody makes. And the avoida consists of 6 or 7 steps. Not just one. You see, you know? And therefore, it's very hard to be an oyved. That's ruchnius. You see? Very hard. Today's time to be there, you know. So that's all part of the Mi'at Or, which is Gzera, and the Holocaust was nothing more than stage one. And most people think it ended in 1945. They have no idea. It's like just total ignorance of what's happening. Well, I don't blame them because it's not Shkofa. That's it. You guys now know what's happening. We are still in the middle of a terrible Gzera, and it's getting worse. It was much worse than it was in 1950.
Isn't the statistic that more Jews have been lost to assimilation than in the Shoah?
Yeah, I would say so. Sure. The Shoah, they lost 6 million Jews, right?
To assimilation.
Today we have 11 million Jews that are gone. Not 6, 11. You know? And that was the second stage. You know, put them in the tumul. First one was to get rid of them physically. The second thing is be mekamed them. Put them in America, you know, the heir of Rav in Israel. No one else will take care of them. So we are so immersed in the tumor, the distractions, all this stuff, that's killing us. Really, the West killed Jews. The West finished off Hitler's job. That was why Hitler was a fool. You see, he was a fool in the end. Because Hitler, Yimach Shemoy, was like, what's his name, Bollock. He thought you can kill the Jews. But Bilam was much smarter. He said, you don't have to kill the Jews physically. You just wipe them out ruchnius, and that's all. And they're finished, you know? So Edom, Esav, and Erev, those guys are Bilam. Hitler was Bollock. He thought you can destroy the Jews physically. He didn't know what he's talking about. That's their mistake. But Bilam was right. Hey, okay, let's get your girls, you know? I'll wipe them out. And of course, the same thing. Erev Rav and Edom, they destroy the Jews. Much more than physical. They're gone. Let's see.
So
anyway.
What, any advice for the people here in this room, what we can do to help turn things around in a better way, other than being it this year?
Yeah.
End with some practical piece of advice, if you have. Or that too.
No.
always like to be able to do something.
Who?
I said, we always want to be able to do something.
Yeah.
Hard to hear this information without wanting to go out there.
The advice that I would give you is in the Torah. Okay? When the Rishon, when they were by Kriya Samsov, most people overlook this. They really overlook this. It's incredible. That is the advice. When the Jews were standing at Kriya Samsov, yes? Why did they get out of Egypt? How? With what schus did they get out? So people think they got out because what? They didn't change their names, the address, or the language. That's not really why they got out. That's what enabled them to be identified as Jews. So God wanted to take out Jews. So if you're not even a Jew, who's there to take out? But what got them out, what got the Jews out, right, was Shmiras HaLoshon. The Medrash says three times in the Medrash, Medrash Rabbah, that Lo Yidah Lo Yisroel Mitzrayim, the reason why the Jews were got out of Egypt, Bishul Shelo Hoyo Behem Dilturia. There was no people speaking Lashon Hara. It's Medrash, it's not me. In fact, the Klei Yoko, take a look where Moshe Rabbeinu says, Hei No Yaminu Li, they will not believe me. So there's a Klei Yoko, it's an incredible Klei Yoko, that brings down this Medrash. And he said, Moshe Rabbeinu's problem was this. What was Moshe Rabbeinu's problem? He said, because Moshe Rabbeinu, in the beginning, when he said, Ochei No Yidah Adoba, surely the matter is known. Remember one Jew was hitting another Jew and he said, hey, Russia, why are you hitting your fellow Jew? And the guy said, we'll make you the horse.
Yeah.
Right? So Moshe Rabbeinu says a very strange statement, Ochei No Yidah Adoba. Surely the matter is known. So the Pashup Shad is surely the matter that what? That he killed the Mitzri is going to be known to Paro. But Rashi says that's not what he really said. What he really said is that I don't understand why the Jews are the most persecuted nation of all. Okay? So what he said, Ochei No Yidah Adoba, he said, nah, you know why? Because these Jews want to inform upon me about Lashon Hara. And therefore, the fact that they sin is known to the Satan. Therefore, Lashon Hara reveals the sins of the Jews to the Satan. And therefore, he prosecutes. That's the secret of Lashon Hara. So therefore, at the end, since Moshe Rabbeinu knew that the Jews are in... the word paroi is really two words. Pe-ra. Bad mouth. You see? Anyway.
So they didn't speak Lashon Hara.
Who?
Datan and Amiram, the two Jews that were fighting each other.
Yeah, of course.
So in other words, they didn't
that's what
all
he was talking about.
No. Wait, no, that's what Moshe Rabbeinu said.
Yeah.
Okay, surely the matter is known because Jews speak Lashon Hara.
Right.
And therefore,
right.
What they do, which is Avodah Zorah, by the way, that's what they were doing in Egypt. You know that from the Yamsuf, where the angels said, these worship idols and these worship idols. Why do you want to save the Jews, right? So the fact that they're worshipping idols was known to the Sultan, because they spoke Lashon Hara. And therefore, it was invested in Ketuvah. So therefore, at the end of time, God appears to Moshe Rabbeinu and says, take them out. Moshe Rabbeinu says, I can't take them out because they still speak Lashon Hara. Mm-hmm. So there's a reason they're still there. So Moshe says, no, they don't speak anymore. It's astounding. And that's why he said, take it in, put it inside, take it out with Saras, which is a sign of Lashon Hara. Put it back in, take it out. It was cured. God was telling Moshe that the Jews stopped speaking Lashon Hara in Egypt. It's amazing, it doesn't say why. It
doesn't say what event happened.
No, it doesn't say what
happened.
The same
thing happened with the stick. He turned the stick into a snake and then...
Well, that yeah. Well,
that was part of the same process.
Process, yeah. But that was where the Sultan is finished. He's dead. But anyway, so God said, no, they don't speak Lashon Hara. You see? So what got the Jews out of Egypt really is Shmiras HaLoshon. It's astounding. Why? Because you think about that. Because really they were supposed to be there how many years? 400 years. That's what he said to Yitzchak, right? But they were really only there how much?
210.
So the Sultan is up there screaming his head off, right? Excuse me, we can't take these guys out. It's still another 190 years to go. So therefore what the Rosham needed is no prosecutions. But the only way to stop the prosecution is no Lashon Hara. So therefore they got out because there were no prosecutions. So the Rosham could do it. Right? So
So therefore, here they're standing at Yam Suf, right? And the Egyptians are on their back. In front of them is a sea. What's the logical thing they're going to start speaking? Lashon Hara. Moshe Rabbeinu, how do you do this to us? Remember the old Yad, you know? You took us in the Egypt. You, what did you do? So the, later on they said, you took us in the desert to die? What's wrong? Yeah. They weren't enough graves in Egypt? Wow. I mean, talk about Lashon Hara. It's not Lashon Hara, it's Moshe Shemrach. Because then the Geulah problem, the Geulah will occur, and the Chinuch problem will go away. Because that's the Klipa. You know, that's the, you know. One, as the Russian proceeds with the Geulah, then the Torah comes out of the Geulah fully. And we now have total availability of the Torah. You see, where now the Ruchnis is much easier. All of it is solved. But the key is the Atim Tachrishim. If you want to be able to, for me to continue doing what I do, you need to be silent. And silent means not shtika, it means no lashon hara. What I'm telling you is a very important secret. The secret of redemption that we need to do is no lashon hara. And therefore you need to learn the halachas. If Klaus will do that, what does it say? He didn't go out to Eschem Achas Kureishis. Behold, I will redeem you. The second redemption, like the first, just like the first redemption happened because of Shmir Saloshim, the second redemption will also happen. And that answers your question.
So that ends the Geulah.
What?
That ends the Geulah at Sinas Chinam, the expression of which is Lashon Hara.
You know what I'm saying? It's like a party. Lashon Hara creates Sinas Chinam.
Yeah.
And Sinas Chinam destroys Achdus of Klal Yisrael. And the Achdus of Klal Yisrael, when that's destroyed, there goes Avos Yisrael.
Right.
It's like these guys are what's called a quartet.
Yeah,
the quartet. You know what quartet is? The first part of the quartet, you know what quartet is, right? First is Lashon Hara, then Sinas Chinam, then Purim Klal Yisrael, and then no Avos Yisrael. That's quartet. They always come together. That's why these are the essential mitzvahs. The essential mitzvah is ben odem chaviroi. That's the essential mitzvah. And the Rosh Hashanah says that, the atem tachrisha. That's
Mamish
what he says.
This is your advice.
That is my advice to somebody who asked me. And not only is it my advice, I explained why, the logic of it, why this is what to do. Okay?
Very good.
Thank you.
But you still, but you, the only thing is to end it, you don't know why they stopped speaking Russian.
No, I don't know.
Okay. Nobody knows.
Doesn't say.
So maybe Hashem will do it for us.
Well, you're already doing it. He's already doing it.
Yeah.
Chofetz Chaim started writing the introduction to his Sefer Chofetz Chaim, which is the Bible of Lashon Hara, right? In 1867. That's when he started writing it.
How old is he?
He was born in 1937, I think, or 35. He was almost 30 years old. But it took him 5 years to write the introduction. He began writing the Sefer in 1871. What happened in 1871? That is when Germany became a republic, when Bismarck united all the principalities of Germany. Okay, under Bismarck, under William the First, Kaiser William the First, and he called it the Republic of Germany.
Right.
Germany is our monarch. Germany that's destined World War I, World War II, the Shoah started in the same year that he wrote the Sefer Chofetz Chaim. Because you need the refuah while you have the makom. It's astounding when you look at the So therefore now, if you notice, the whole concept of Shemir Saloshin is what? It's all around. There's a much greater awareness and consciousness of Jews about Lashon Hara.
Thanks.
Why now?
You.
What?
You Prophesy
yeah.
Marriage Foundation.
Why? Because the Atem Tachrishim, what the Rosh Hashanah did is he made sure that this would happen to Klal Yisrael. That the Refuah has to be for the Makkah, and then since the Makkah is what's going to happen before the Mashiach, the Refuah has to be there. And that's why since 1985, there's an incredible awareness now of Lashon Hara. Yeah. Much greater awareness. Yeah. That's why. Now you know why. Why now? You ever wonder?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the answer is, V'atam Tachlishon. That's the answer. There are a lot of stuff that you connect, you see, that really fill out the whole picture of what's going on now.
Because the Chabasai Heritage Foundation, kids now, like my son, and he's growing up in his yeshiva, they were learning the laws of Lashon. When I went to yeshiva, the only thing he knew about Lashon Hara was the song, Lashon Hara Lame. The only thing that he ever heard, the only reference I ever heard about Lashon Hara, my entire yeshiva education.
I have a literal Shmiras HaLashon that we learned in yeshiva, but it was like the Friday was a half a day. It was about 10 minutes.
Now every yeshiva at least teaches a little bit.
Why? Anybody ever ask themselves why?
Yeah, you said so before.
What?
No,
now that you know the answer.
Yeah. No, I mean, well,
that's it. Did anybody ask why? Why was it? I mean, someone woke up to Lashon Hara. You know? Yeah. Because the Gzeir of me at all, right, or the Ikvus the Mashiach has to have Shemir of Lashon. Just like Egypt. Right? Mm-hmm. And the second redemption will be like the first. Same thing. It's an what's called the an equality, you know, it's an equivalency. And by the way, that's the secret of who the Mashiach is, by the way. If you are able to equivalate, whatever the word is, right, the Yetzias Mitzrayim, where today you can mamash see what's going on. Just like I showed you, the Shoiha is equivalent to the intensity, remember? Goyim Mogok is equivalent to Kriya Samsov. Shmir Saloshin happened then. Shmuel, is that you notice what's happening here?
Moshe is a Levi, and the Mashiach will be a Yehuda.
A who?
From Yehuda. In other words, is this Shratim will be
No. No. The Mashiach from Yosef is not Yehuda.
Uh-huh. But would he be a Levi, you think?
Could be anything.
Could be anything. Actually, he could probably either be a Kohen or a Levi, which is more accurate.
Right.
Yeah. Could be. See things. All of a sudden, there's interesting power.
So you've got to see the guy that's getting the most abuse, and that's Mashiach?
Probably. Remember, you know, there are people walking around thinking, because I'm so abused, I must be the Mashiach. That's not true. Means if you are the Mashiach, you are abused terribly. And that's a pasuk in shiur, you know. But it doesn't mean if you are abused, you are the Mashiach. The converse is not true.
That's good.
You can't believe how many guys think, because I'm abused, because I never made it, and so on and so forth, I must be the Messiah. There must be hundreds of guys walking around Jerusalem that look like abused.